your favorite class. You're right. Like, whoa.
I do all the time.
And my co-host for the year is Dr. P.
You know, if you have any questions, and we can go from there. Appreciate your time.
All right, guys, you're back for week two of Chat with Charlie. Unfortunately, my co-host is not here. She is visiting some campuses. So, Dr. Paulette Thomas Collins, we will miss you on this episode, but I know you're here in spirit. And she'll be back for week three, I'm sure, too. And we've got a special Hot Ones coming. Just so you guys know, we're going to do regional edition. So I think it's Monday where we're going to do that, and we'll probably get the video done. And at the end of the week, you'll see Hot Ones Regional Edition. And we've got some new fun stuff we're going to do in that, so I hope you enjoy it. But today, we got Angel. And you know the coolest thing about having Angel here is we didn't have to adjust the mics because we both have the same mic height. So I think we're good. We're good on that. But today, what we're going to be talking about is inspecting what you're expecting. It's an old cliche everybody always says, but as a DOA, there's certain things you want to put out there, but there's certain things you want to put out there and also make sure that they're happening. So I want to talk to Angel. I don't think there's anybody that does it best. She's been here a while. She's one of our top directors of missions. She knows how to run the school. She's been mentored by Paulette. So I think you probably got some good nuggets for us. So first of all, what does that mean to you, inspecting what you expect as a DOA?
I think that means accountability.
Okay.
I think inspecting what you expect is critical because we have to own our starts. We have to manage our teams. We have to be compliant at our campus. So with all of that being said, I own that as accountability.
I like it. So with accountability, just sticking to the start thing, and this is you I'm asking, if you miss a start, whose fault is it?
It's my fault.
Okay. And is that good or bad?
It can be both.
Or it could be neither.
Or it could be neither.
Because as long as you know the solutions of what it is, neither good or bad. You just fix it, right?
That's right.
And you tell me this, because you've probably been there. I've been there. I remember, you know, talking to Christy and Alana. We talked about this, and we beat ourselves up. And I think a sign of someone that's vested in it, you don't have to say anything to them that they haven't said to themselves. Because they're successful. They have that innate drive to do the things. Mm-hmm. But what's hard about this job is having more urgency than the people you work with. And part of that is inspecting what you expect,
absolutely,
right? So talk to us a little bit about that, because we already know you, right? It's no one else's fault. It's not financial aid. It's not the weather. It's not leads. It's not my desk is shaped wrong. It is something that we missed that we have to do differently in the next mod or the next 5 weeks or the next 10 weeks. But how do you do that with someone that you have more urgency than they do? How do you help them?
Definitely coaching. It's an all campus thing here. It's all departments. My team has a sense of urgency. I have a sense of urgency. But there are some departments that may not, but they are vital to our starts, to getting our students through the process. So basically just staying on them, being engaged, being involved, I think it's important. We're not just admissions. We have to be involved with financial aid. We have to be involved with the student services, the coordinators, and you have to put a heightened sense of urgency on that. For example, just the other day, you know, I needed to get some folders flipped. My registrar had a couple meetings our blue file folder.
Okay, blue file folder.
I needed to transition the student from application received to enroll status so that the student could go on and do OCRA and complete the admissions process. I had a conference call coming up, and I wanted to have my numbers solid before the call. That's my sense of urgency. The registrar, however, you know, she's a great registrar, but she has other things that she has to do as well. She's putting in grades, that sort of thing. So I just had to, you know, have that relationship with her. Mm-hmm. Like, hey, listen, I have a call coming up. I'd like to see what we could do to get this done. Is there anything I can do to help you?
Mm-hmm.
Relationships are important. You have to build those. Coming to CPenn after being at a couple different campuses, you know, it was different. Coming into a campus that's already established, you're the new person, you know, you're coming in with this, I need this now attitude. But how are you going to get that done effectively and still keep those relationships strong? So what I do is I ask, what can we do to help you? and I'll let you know what you can do to help me. Mm-hmm. And then we work together.
And that's a partnership.
It's a partnership. And that is what CPN is all about.
I suspect it can take some time to get there if you don't have that.
Yes.
But you can get there. But it's like everything else, you know, in life, you know, you have to work at it. Mm-hmm. No one works for you in a way. We have direct reports, but I think, you know, the successful DOAs that I've encountered have a way of building rapport, not only with clientele, meaning their inquiries, because mm-hmm. that's what we have to do,
right?
But they take that skill set and use it in the campus and not bark what they need, but help them understand what they need so they're with them. You that's know what right. I mean? And you still take them to lunch, you reward them when they, you know, you mm-hmm. you recognize they have a job too. So that's really good, and that's important. And I think it starts the CED too, the leadership meetings, the camaraderie, the working together. It's not silo-driven. Everybody understand what piece of the pie they fit in.
That's right.
Those type of things. So tell me this, like, and I'll give you, for instance, like when I was a DOA, the first thing I would do Monday morning without fail is I pull a lead master listing and I pull a start date report. And the reason why, and then I divide it up, right? I put it into an Excel, do a little pivot table, divide up all the reps. I knew who my Michael Jordans were.
That's right.
I knew who my status players were. I knew who I'm working with, right? To develop them more. And then I'd say, okay, what did we accomplish last week? What do we need to accomplish this week? And I didn't use, which is fun. Some people find this funny. I didn't use a lot of numerics with them. I just knew where the numerics were. And then knew what I needed to do with them as a person to get more of them for the week. Meaning, if they're low on appointments and they had no interviews, help them prioritize their day with outbound, or help them prioritize day with call blocking, mm-hmm. or whatever it is. Or maybe they're not texting and they're having low connect times. Well, are you texting with calling? You know, those type of things. So you got to inspect it. And then the other thing, you know, let's say they had a ton of interviews. But then this week, they don't have a lot because they didn't have time to mine and get more appointment sets in. So you help them block out that time and things like that. Right. Or you pull your start date. The app's, you know, you got in January 1st. It's now February 2nd, and they're still in primary. You know what I mean? You don't wait till scrub and stuff like that. And those are just minor things. But I found pulling just those two reports and knowing my people – how they dressed when they came in. Are they all wrinkled, big old bags in their eyes? They have a bender all night. Are they making eye contact with me? You know, are they sitting at the water cooler or getting coffee for an hour and just talking about the weekend? You know, I try to look at all those little things and then talk to them individually, but not officially. So talk to me about your, that's my style. Mm-hmm. Talk to me about your style to get, and you've heard me say this before, we want to make someone extraordinary. That's ordinary, because we're all ordinary. Right. Our job is to make them extraordinary, because they're going to be talking to people we've got to make extraordinary on the phone.
That's right. Right.
So talk to me about your kind of strategy and keeping them in the lane for success.
Absolutely. So what I do is when I come in the mornings, and this is every morning, I'm definitely pulling my reports, lead master listing, start date. I also like to pull my start date enrollment stats. Sometimes that's a little bit quicker. I can, you know, pivot it up by packaging and role status and just see my movement a little bit quicker. I meet with my team. I meet with them in a group setting, but I also meet with them individually, because it's, you can't manage the whole team the same way. Everyone's motivated differently. I have a representative who is a superstar. She came to me from CVAB. Great.
Sarah rep. Let her go?
She was at CVAB.
Oh, with
James
CVAB. Ray. I was thinking Chesapeake for a second.
She was with James
Strike
Ray.
That from the record, Sarah. You didn't lose anybody.
She is an awesome rep. However, she's easily distracted.
Yeah.
So keeping her in lane. I sometimes will call her into my office and say, hey, listen. For example, I left the campus an hour early the other day. And I just wanted to see, without telling anyone when I came back, inspecting what I expect. What happened when I left the campus? How did the workflow? Did it stop? Did it slack off? Was anyone lollygagging, moving around at the call?
Don't say lollygagging. Paulette's going to pick up on that word.
Oh, I kind of saw your video too, and it slipped out. I promised I wouldn't say
it. Sorry, Paulette.
Yeah, sorry, Paulette. So just bouncing around, doing numerous things, and there were minimal calls made. So first I had to ask myself, well, maybe she was doing text blast. Maybe she was wrapping up her day. You know, I want to know what's going on. So I brought her in and I said, hey, can you talk to me about what happened yesterday during this particular time? Because when I left, we talked about doing, you know, certain things. And she was honest and she said, you know, I had just had so many applications yesterday. I really just needed to breathe. Mm-hmm. And I said, you know, there's nothing wrong with that. Mm-hmm. It's okay to breathe, but you must remain consistent. You said you wanted leadership and you wanted to be grown for leadership. So you have to do what's right when no one else is looking. Mm-hmm. Because what I saw is not what you did all day. I saw what you did when I walked away. So she appreciated that.
Isn't that love? I mean, I don't want to get all corny on this, but if you truly care about the individual, mm-hmm. it's not about your needs. It's about addressing it.
Yeah.
And I love what you said. You allowed her to tell you what it was, didn't assume.
Right.
Because you know her. You know what she wants in her future. Mm-hmm. And then you correlated that into a training moment.
A coaching moment.
Right?
Absolutely.
Or a coaching moment.
Yeah. And she appreciated that. And we reviewed it, and I told her, you know, I gave her some examples when I was an admissions rep, and I wanted to be, Mr. Merritt used to call, you know, who's going to be my superstar today? And I always wanted to be the superstar. You know, I'm raising my hand, me. But I had to show him what it was that he needed. I had to give him what he needed. I had to produce, and I had to be consistent. So she really came back to me, and she said, I just want to thank you, you know. And she was a little teary-eyed, so it was kind of emotional for her. She appreciated the time that I took with her, and she also knows what I expect now. So I can guarantee you that probably won't happen again.
And she respects you. And I think, you know, when I listen to this, and hopefully you guys picked up on this too, but a lot of DOAs want to be liked and not respected. Mm. I think you've got to be respected, and the people that should be in your department will like you because of the respect that they have for you.
That's right.
I think we get a little convoluted. We have a hard time with those tough conversations and things like that. Again, these are nuggets, but I want you to think about the real kind of essence of what we're talking about. The other thing I want to say too is admissions is a full-time job.
Absolutely. It never ends.
It is. What happened where people think that it's not a full-time job, that they can do all this other stuff?
It doesn't work out.
It doesn't work out. I pulled data 4 or 5 times mm-hmm. a day. One, because really as a DOA, when you have a big team, if you're not a producing DOA, mm-hmm. there's two things. If you're producing DOA, you got to set your calendar right because you got to give back like you're talking about. But also you got to train by showing, getting out in the cubicle, picking up that phone, rocking some appointments, taking them to application.
That's right.
That's different. But then you get a bigger team and you got more different needs. And then you got 8 hours. So you got to figure out what you're going to do with your time. And I remember I used to put in my calendar 4 times a day. Actually, maybe more, but I think it was 4 times a day. I would put walk around just to remind me, even though I walked around more because I hated being in my office. Mm-hmm. But I had to remind myself, walk around, cut it up with people, because even that can be motivational, because you can use cutting up in a work type setting if you got the right team and you got to build it, right?
That's
I think you see
so
where I'm going.
Right. That's so right.
But the thing that I worry about, and it's been a while since I've been a DOA, is I don't know how you train that into young DOAs, is that, guys, this is a full-time job. You take your data, you figure out a narrative, you know your people, and you drive them as a leader, not as a cog in the wheel. And I've always felt that DOAs that are a cog in the wheel, meaning they're the senior rep, mm-hmm. right? I'm not talking about title, mm-hmm. but they're a senior rep and they're all codependent on that person. Mm-hmm. Where I think you and I agree, you got to build individual DOAs out there and let them run their own business. And you're on that watchtower.
That's right.
Navigating them by the data you see, the countenance that they show, and how they're, you know, not manipulating the day in a negative sense, but manipulating the day for the benefit of the good of their role, like blossom where you're planted.
And time management.
And time management is a killer with us. Email, you're trying to get in the zone, then you mm-hmm. do these emails. So talk to me a little bit about your approach to individuals, whether they're a high performer, you know, kind of a steady Eddie, or someone mm-hmm. you're bringing up skill gap. How do you keep 8 hours a day fresh in you? And let me just add to this, because it gets old. One of the sayings is, when you get the job, when you first get it, you're usually on fire. You got all these ideas, you do all these things, but then over time you lose it. How do you keep that fire? Because it's an 8-hour job.
It is.
Period. If not more.
It is. And it goes back to individual motivation for your reps, mm-hmm. recognizing those who are doing well, coaching everyone. But I think it's important to have that relationship with your team, where even though there's a level of professionalism there, but be realistic. You know, be who you are. It's okay to walk around. I mean, I know you're going to be walking to the
be vulnerable.
You know, exactly. In a sense, right? Yeah. In a sense. And let them know it's okay. I let my team know, hey, listen, you've made numerous amount of calls. It's okay to step back and take a break and maybe walk over to the education building. It's okay to do that. You know, reset, come back and get back into the game. But the game is not over. It's not over. And I need you to continue to play. So being realistic, being in the weeds with them, setting the tone. You know, letting them see, hey, I'm not just saying, okay, we need 10 apps. We lost two students yesterday. That's a prime example. We lost two students, and instead of me saying, you know, oh, geez, Lord, we lost two students. It starts Monday. What are we going to do? Hey, it's time for me to call. Hey, team, come on, let's get together.
Rally
Coach
them
time.
Up.
Yeah, let's go to my office.
Call blitz or
yeah,
do
let's do
else
it. This is what we're going to do. I'm going to print leads. We're all going to do a call blast. I'm going to sit in the office next to you all. Hey, you know, every time someone sets an appointment, we're all going to, you know, do a chant. You know, whatever it is that we need to do, but just to keep that energy going. It has to be exciting to them. It can be draining for a rep. I've had a rep tell me I'm drained.
If they're doing the job as it's supposed to be, mm-hmm. they're going to hate it mm-hmm. if they don't have interviews coming in.
Yep.
But if they're not doing the job that they're supposed to be, they're going to love their job. If you get what I mean.
And it's a fine line right
yep,
there.
It's a fine line.
Mm-hmm. I think that the thing that I have with my team, and I try to have it, I have to, you know, stay in control of how far I go, but I understand my reps. I was a rep. I let them know that I was a rep. I know what you need. I know what I needed, you know, mm-hmm. and if you can give me what I need, I'm going to give you what you need. I'm going to give you the tools. If you can give me what I need, I'm going to give you what you need.
I love that. Mm-hmm. All right, we gotta close it up. Like I say, these are nuggets, but I invite you guys, reach out to Angel, ask her more questions on this, because she's dropped some really good things that I think we can easily gloss over. Because the DOA job is not hard. We make it hard. But if you keep it real simple on those finer things, just a few things, you'll be successful. So one last thing. I believe, this is my opinion now, that a rep shouldn't have multi things that they need to deliver. Meaning you got to have your call volume. You got to have these appointment sets. You got to have this talk time. You got to have this, got to have that. I believe in the one thing. There's a movie about that. Do you have a one thing that they know? This is what Angel's about. If I don't do anything because they're just dominoes of this thing, mm-hmm. I deliver this.
Results.
Give me an example of result.
I need you to come in. I need you to be consistent. I need you to be compliant. And I need you to follow the process.
I love that.
All of that equals results.
I love that. So your results, let me hit you with one and tell me what you think. So my thing, and I think I've said this, in fact, I think I gave you a heart attack when I said this.
I don't care how many calls.
You knew you remember this. This is like 2 years ago. Yes. You looked at me with like death stare. You're like, who the hell are you doing to me right now?
Don't say this in front of my team.
But for me, I didn't believe, I didn't care about call. I didn't care if he made 0, 1, 5,000. I did not care. I feel like that's brushing your teeth. Like you do that, you're going to have stinky breath. Mm-hmm. You got to do it, right?
Right.
I didn't even care about appointment sets because, you know, get better at it. That's your stats, right? You should be like Michael Jordan. If your free throw stat is low, get in there and raise your free throw stat, right?
Right.
What I cared about was interviews. Mm-hmm. That was it. I wanted 10 interviews a week.
Yep.
Right? I think we've talked about this, right?
Yep.
And if you didn't get those 10 interviews, I'd work on the front end process. I would look at calls. I'd look at those things. But I didn't expect those things because that's not what makes the campus successful is calls. What makes the campus successful, I feel, and this is opinion, is walking in those hallways, seeing the training aides, seeing the caring professionals. And then if you don't have apps from that, then I got something else to work with. How you doing commitment, how you, you know, those type of things. Mm-hmm. So my one thing was interview, your one thing is results. But I think every DOA, and I want to get your thought on this, they got to have just one thing. I feel like we throw all this stuff we want from our reps, mm-hmm. and really what we want should be one thing. What do you think when I say that?
And it is one thing that we want at the end of the day, but there's so many different ways to get to that mm-hmm. one thing. So my thing is, I'm not going to beat you down all day. Like, you haven't made this call. You don't have this. You don't have that. But if you don't have results and you're not meeting the expectation, I've got to take you there. you know? So it goes back to what I said in the beginning, managing those reps, encouraging those reps, keeping them positive, keeping them motivated, and having those relationships with your team. That's going to make it happen. They're going to want to work for you.
We're going to do five more minutes here because I want to hit you with one more thing. I've talked to DOAs that get so worried about the numerics for themselves, start rate percentage, conversion percentage, whatever, and they forget the most important thing. Knowing me how you know me, if you met or exceeded your start, but your start rate was lower than it should have been, say, you know, the average is 59% or 60%, mm-hmm. and you came in 49%, something crazy, but you met or exceeded your start, what is the most important thing, not as a rep now, the one thing, what is the most important thing as the DOA?
I think the most important thing is we need to peel back the onion to see what we can do so that we can, A, tighten up your show rate, make sure that you're successful, make sure that, you know, you're not blowing through my leads. It's the most important thing for me right
Absolutely.
Now.
because, but, yeah, they're just cranking and trying to get a yes and not even spending
the
time.
Against the wall and see what's going to stick. Like, I really
it's
need.
It's transactional at that point.
Yeah. And just making sure that they are training. Training is so important, that making sure that they are coached and trained. If you train your reps, once you've they've given you the data and you can look at that data and see, okay, if we could do this differently, or if I could sharpen her up on this end, then, you know, we could do more. I want all of my reps to be great. I
Equally.
Want them, exactly. I want them all to be a reflection of what I'm pouring into them. So I spend a lot of time coaching. I don't believe in a high turnover rate. For me, if you have a high turnover rate, and I know this is a little bit off of the topic, but I think it's important, and I want to say this to all DOAs. When you have a high turnover rate for admissions reps, you have to look at yourself. You have to look at yourself. It's important. This is a hard job, dealing with a lot of people, keeping your teams motivated, even when they're having bad days, and just being in the trenches with them. I believe in coaching. Coaching,
and
training.
And that's a full-time
training,
job there.
It is.
And I think you know from our training, the number one thing for a DOA is your people. That's
right.
It.
That's
Everything
right.
else will fall into place if you take care of your people. Role-playing, coaching, just being that bartender sometimes and just listening to them, right? Mm-hmm. That's good. I want to go back to this real quick because I do want to make this point because the DOAs I've talked to. And here's what it is. Don't beat yourself up on a start rate if you've done what you needed to do and overproduce on your gross. Mm-hmm. What you need to do is figure out how you can improve that start rate, but you still got a W because you found another way to get to the end zone. Some DOAs want to hit a metric so much, they'll sacrifice the other because they want to have good. Meaning, they'll sacrifice their gross. Well, I don't want to have a bad start rate. How does that look on me? When they're missing the point of the job, mm-hmm. and the job is good customer service to bring in graduates. Mm-hmm. Start rate we can fix. Missing starts can have multiple areas. So as a rep has a one thing, right?
Right.
I believe a DOA has one thing with those other ingredients to find out later. But like if you're trending bad in your start, don't sacrifice a start because you don't want to be seen with a bad start rate. Crank that gross. Like you said, hey, let's go. Mm-hmm. Bring them in. Let's go. Let's go. Pushing. Let's do some call blitzing. We got three more days. We got to make up these cancels we took and things like that. And then talk about the start rate later. But you got to exceed your gross.
Get the business in.
So the one thing is meeting those budgets and meeting the needs of those students. Not bringing in any Tom, Dick, or Harry kind of thing, right. But meeting the thing for the customer service. But I want people to know you got to have, not only your reps have to have an eye on the thing, as a DOA, you have to have your eye on the prize and have confidence in you that, yeah, my start rate stinks. It's lower than it's ever been. But here's what I did. I increased my gross to compensate for that so that I will meet the needs of the campus, which is our start goals. You get what I mean?
And that's what happened for me this start in January. When I left for the holidays, I was, I think, 94% to goal. And the bottom fell out.
They hate it.
Oh,
when walking we came out back, to your car, oh going, my God, yeah,
I can't believe this. I feel like I've been at 35 for like 3 weeks now. And so when I came back after the holidays, and I'm thinking to myself, like, you know, what happened? I went through my start rate, looked at every cancel. What happened? What was the reason? Is it something we could have controlled? You can only control what you can control.
That's right.
However, you have to overcompensate. So teaching my reps that, hey, yeah, your run rate this week for you individually is 3. But don't stop at 3. Don't look at the number. Just keep going.
Just keep going.
Just keep going.
And that's why it's a full-time job. Mm-hmm. All right, guys, that's week 2 of training. Next week, we will have another round. We're actually going to have 2 things. We're going to have a training round with my co-host, Dr. Paulette, and then we're also going to have the hot ones that we'll be doing. I think it's on Thursday or something like that. But then, no, it's on Monday, and then we'll have time to cut it up. And that'll be the regional edition. And I think you guys are going to learn a lot about the regionals that are in this position. We're even going to talk a little bit about how they got to their position. From wherever they were, from a rep or something else that they got to the regional position. So I think there's going to be some good Q&A on that. With that, have a great day. You gave a lot of good stuff, and I really mean this. There's a lot of stuff I just don't want to gloss over. So please call Angel, think about what she's saying, and find ways to make this job so impactful in admissions, because that is where you're at as a director of admissions. Have a great day. We'll see you guys.